This elegant launch can go upstream or downstream, irrespective of the wind. It's powered by a small steam engine. For the whole of human history, man's only source of power was muscle, wind, and water. That all changed with steam. The man who discovered how to power the world was not a rich Etonian gentleman like Joseph Banks, but the son of a Scottish craftsman. His name was James Watt, and his steam engine was to drive the Industrial Revolution. And while Cook and Banks were sailing to the other side of the world, Watt was struggling with prototypes in his Glasgow workshop. I spent 5 years building 5,127 prototypes, so I know how he felt. James Watt was the son of a shipbuilder on the Clyde, and he would spend time in his father's workshop, much like this, taking things apart and putting them back together again.
As an inventor, you always hope for the eureka moment, but the truth is often far more prosaic. And so it was with Watt's discovery. The story goes that he was inspired by watching the lid lifting on a boiling kettle. In fact, his interest in the power of steam began when he was asked to mend a broken model of an already existing steam engine. In 1764, a broken Newcomen engine arrived in Watt's workshop. There were dozens in existence, used for pumping water out of mines. But they were inefficient and expensive to run. This waste of energy began to obsess Watt. He couldn't believe there wasn't a more efficient and much cheaper way of doing things. Then it suddenly occurred to him what was wrong. Steam was injected into the cylinder and then condensed with cooling water to make a vacuum to pull down the piston. To get steam back into the system, the whole thing had to be heated up all over again. The answer was to cool and condense the steam in a separate chamber, outside the main cylinder, instead of inside it. This would speed the cycle up, as well as saving energy. This was James Watt's great idea.
That was a breakthrough, because it meant that you wouldn't have to heat and cool and heat and cool the cylinder and the piston with every stroke. That would be a wonderful saving of energy and allow the engine to be 3 times more efficient than the Newcomen engine. Fired with enthusiasm, James Watt rushed back into his workshop. Within a few days, he had got the system working. But although it was a moment of genius, it would be 10 years before he had a full-size working steam engine.
The future had arrived. Watt's monsters throbbed day and night. And there seemed no limit to the power they gave to man.
And here it is, a James Watt steam engine. Over here, we have the big counterbalance weight of 16 tons, and the pump can lift 3/4 of a ton of water up to 200 feet. And here's the piston going down into the huge cylinder. And underneath my feet, Watt's great invention, a separate condenser, out of the way, exactly as it should be. James Watt's invention changed the world. He gave almost unlimited power for mines, for factories, for transport, and even the power to make electricity. He made the future and our present.
This was the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Britain was the first nation to industrialize. Watt himself made a fortune. setting up factories, taking out patents, devising new and ever more impressive machinery to harness the power of steam. Where Britain went, the world followed, and the modern economy was born.
But while Watt was toiling away in his Glasgow workshop, a fellow Scot was scouring the back streets of London, buying corpses. Modern surgery may seem miraculous, but in fact it's the result of centuries of research into the human body and how it works. And the roots of modern surgery can be found in the stinking streets and stews of 18th century London. Then, medicine was a horror show. But in the entrails of the dead, one man was seeking the truth. His name was John Hunter.
And here he is, in a painting by Joshua Reynolds, in the Royal College of Surgeons. There's the intense look on his face, this obsessive workaholic surrounded by all the wonderful objects in biology which so fascinated him.
But Hunter's interest in the wonders of nature was tied to his determination to discover how the body really worked, and so how to operate on it.
An 18th century surgeon was more butcher than scientist. Cut and cauterize were the basic techniques, and speed was essential because there were no anesthetics. A good surgeon with instruments like this could take off a leg in 15 seconds flat. And if the patient didn't die of shock, there was always the severe risk of infection. The problem, of course, was ignorance. Nobody really knew how the body worked. So what the surgeon did was to cut and hope for the best.
Like James Watt, John Hunter came from a relatively humble background in lowland Scotland. He came to London to join his older brother, already a well-established surgeon. John's most important job was finding bodies for dissection and demonstration. He mingled with the lowlife around Covent Garden, paying good money for fresh corpses. Some came straight from the gallows, others from the graves of paupers, courtesy of freelance body snatchers known as resurrectionists. But out of this gruesome world, he discovered he had an exceptional talent for dissection.
Hunter's determination to drag surgery out of the Middle Ages and put it on a scientific basis meant making accurate maps of the body and how the parts interact and function. And that meant anatomizing both animals and humans, normal and abnormal.
Hunter did hundreds of dissections, and little by little, he built up a detailed knowledge of human anatomy. This was the basis for his surgical technique. He soon built a reputation as the surgeon least likely to kill you. He knew what he was doing. And that's why he was willing to take on the cases nobody else would touch. So, in October 1775, when a ship's rigger called John Burley, with a facial tumor twice the size of his head, arrived at St. George's Hospital, he'd come to the right place. He had heard that John Hunter was different from other surgeons.